Good evening, viewers. Welcome to People and Stories. I'm your host, Jackie Naluvama. Tonight, we have a very interesting guest, Lena Pira. She came to Uganda as a missionary, but she branched into publishing. Let's hear how she moved from the pulpit to books.
Hi, Jackie. Thank you so much for having me. It's great to be here.
Thanks for accepting. Yes, you talked about leaving California in 2009. Were you born and raised in California?
Born and raised. My whole life I was there.
Okay.
Yes.
So how hard was it or easy was it to make a move, to move to Uganda permanently?
I think it was hard at the beginning. But once I heard God's voice tell me to come to Uganda, it became a bit easier and things started aligning to ensure that I could get here. So it took me, I think God told me in 2004, it took me about 5 years before I actually found my way here, but over the course of time, he made a way.
Oh, some would say you're big-headed. 5 years to
hear
God.
No, I heard him in 2004, okay. And I heard him again in 2006. I took actions. When he called me, I said, okay, God, let me do something. And so I started getting involved with Uganda then. I first came in 2006 for like 2 weeks. Okay. Then in 2007, I came for a month. And after that, my church leaders in California kept asking me, when are you moving to Uganda? And at first I was like, no, I'm never moving to Uganda. I told them, no way. Okay. Until God spoke to me a third time. And then I was convicted to come and got my one-way ticket. And here I am then.
When you say God spoke to you, we would like to understand, how exactly did you hear him? Did you see him in a vision? Did a bird chirp a certain way? How did you speak to Lena?
Well, the first two times when God told me to come to Uganda, what happened was I was sitting in a church auditorium and a children's choir, Ugandan children's choir, came to sing. And as they were singing, I heard God tell me, go to Uganda.
Which choir was that?
That was the Mangaza choir from Gaba Community Church.
Okay.
So I heard God, and I told God, but I don't know where Uganda is. I don't know how to get there. So you'll just make a way. So I left it up to him, and I sponsored children from that choir. And so I kind of just left it be. Now the third time when God made it very, very clear that I needed to move, I was reading a book. And as I read the book, God convicted me from what? A Bible verse of the rich young ruler. Because I had been asking God, I had already come to Uganda twice, and I said, okay, God, I know you want me to go, but, you know, I'm comfortable in California, you know, I have a permanent job, I get a raise every year, I can... You know, I have 2 months off every year. I can come to Uganda, you know, every single year and still
on
short-term missions. Mm-hmm. And that's when God convicted me with the passage of the rich young ruler and told me, I've called you to Uganda. If you don't follow me there, for you it's sin. That hurt me. I was like, wow, so God, you're telling me to follow you there or turn away and go, turn around and do my own thing. I said, you know what, I'll go. And I've never looked back.
What job was that in the
US? I was a school teacher for the Los Angeles Unified School District.
Oh.
Yes, so.
Teaching what grade?
Thing. I was teaching lower primary, kindergarten, and special needs courses. So I had about 30 students every year.
Oh, wow.
Yes, yeah.
So you left all that to
I left it. I actually had to retire from my teaching position because I was tenured. I couldn't be fired.
Okay.
I actually, after 3 years of being in Uganda, I wrote in my retirement to LA Unified and told them I'm retiring. I think I was 31 when I officially retired. So there you go.
So when you came to Uganda on mission, okay, permanent mission, did you think that the first way to serve God would also be in, you know, the child ministry?
Actually, I came with what I had. Being a trained teacher, mm-hmm. I'd been trained in curriculum development and early childhood education. And so I joined with Gaba Community Church and Africa Renewal Ministries at the beginning. And they were doing child sponsorship programs. They were doing university programs, primary and secondary school programs. And so I did a lot of curriculum development for their leadership programs as well as their university. And so I wasn't to say your typical missionary that's maybe on a pulpit. My preaching came through the curriculum I was developing for the kids, the teachers I was training to teach that content, and then also we started a diploma program at their university, so we hired professors to teach others to work with kids.
So that curriculum, is it Christian based?
It is. Everything I've done is Christian based, yeah.
So you, permit me to ask, lately people are going for, they're in support of accelerated Christian education, that curriculum. Is it you we should thank for that?
I can't take responsibility for bringing it. I think it's the Mugaras who brought it to Uganda, but it's been around, I think, in the US since the 1970s. Mm. I've trained a bit in it, I've learned about it, and it really seems like a good option for people that want an alternative to the national curriculum.
How different is it? Just tell us what makes it stand out.
Well, it's self-paced. So a student will come in where they're at, they take an assessment that shows where they're strong and where they're weak, and then they start learning in those paces. So they wouldn't say, okay, I'm in fifth grade or P7. They might say in math, I'm in P3, but in English, I'm in P8, and they start learning from those different levels so that they can come back, strengthen their weaknesses, and then continue growing.
So at what point do they find their equilibrium?
Usually they have to do some catch-up work at the beginning. So they do some, and then they continue on. But it's fast-paced, so if a student is really, really, you know, yeah, and focused, they can do two grades in 1 year. They're not held back
by the
structure, because it's self-paced. So a child who's motivated can really finish, go quickly. Like they can go as fast or slow as they need to. So in that way, it's really good because it meets a child where they are, but it also brings God into every aspect of the curriculum. So, you know, there's God in English, there's God in math, there's God in science, there's God in... So, you know, because God created the whole world. So if you're going to learn science, you might as well learn the aspects of what God created, and, you know, instead of us studying evolution and, you know, those things. So that's what the interesting part of that curriculum.
Some skeptics can say that Jesus' math is different. How can you get 5 loaves and 2 fish?
Exactly. 1 + 1 = 1.
But okay, that's interesting. So moving on from missionary work, at what point did you take a detour into publishing?
Well, it's so interesting. I was doing curriculum development with a lot of people in the setting I was at Africa Renewal Ministries. And with curriculum, you spend maybe 3-4 years developing a curriculum, and then you let it run on its own, you know? And so you might pick up
hold
and...
Hold on. When developing a curriculum, what do you really look out for?
You have to do an analysis of really the environment, the needs, what they need to study or learn, what the outcomes are, where the students will be, who will teach them. Like, you have to look at every angle. Yeah, so it can take 3-4 years. When we developed the diploma at Africa Renewal University, I think it took us about 2 years to develop that program, and it involved studying. I went to Malaysia, I went, networked with some people at UCU, so it is a very complex process for years. So, but once you have something running, you really kind of just watch and tweak. There's not a lot of, you know, major changes.
So when you roll it out, you first pilot it.
Yes, you pilot it, make small tweaks, make sure it's running, and then it can run on its own. For now, it's been running for many, many years, about 10, 12 years now. But when that happens, we would go to the next curriculum, until we ran out of curriculum to develop. And then people there would be like, but if Lina can write curriculum, she can surely help us with books.
Okay.
And you know, there was pastors there because we were connected to a church. Mm-hmm. And so I started getting people who are interested in, hey, Lina, can you help me with my book? Lina, can you help me with this?
Okay.
And that's how I ended up in publishing. So I think the first book we did around 2014, 2013, around there. Mm-hmm. And I've been doing it ever since. And now I actually do more books than I do curriculum.
So when it comes to books, the publishing industry, How are we doing? How are we faring as Uganda?
I think we are improving over the years. The reading culture seems to be picking up. Ugandans seem to be more and more interested in books and also writing. Back in the day, I didn't used to have a lot of interest in people needing help with books, but today I can tell you I get at least 2 or 3 phone calls a day. People who either want to write, they want to find out where to buy books, you know, so I really think reading is picking up.
As a publisher, what do you think of people reading from their own authors as opposed to foreign authors? What do we gain from reading our own?
I think it's important to have a mix, because what we expose our minds to, one, we have to be careful. Whether it's a local person or an external person, we have to be careful what we are putting in our minds. But two, to have a wide breadth of everything is important, because then you're able to speak to each person in each thing. So, for instance, I helped an author who became a widow at 29. The book is called Widows Wear Lipstick. But so I helped her with this book, and when she wrote this book, she wrote first about the story of being widowed, and second, the second half, how people can go through grief. And so now, when I come across people that have been widowed in Uganda, because I read that book, I know the cultural aspects of how to minister to someone who's maybe lost a spouse or a father or a sibling based on her story. So it gives me her experience. I don't have to go through what she went through to be able to help someone else, but it's because I read that story. And so it kind of gives you experience without you having to take the hard route of going through it yourself.
She went through it for all of us.
She went through it for everyone, and now she can minister to people. And when I buy her book or I read her book, I can also help people as she would. It's like I have her knowledge, and I can help minister in that area. Or I can give someone a book who's going through a hard time and say, you know what, this book, I found it helpful. You might also find it helpful. And so those things, I think that's very important. It's very important for us to read local, but also international, because it widens your perspective on things.
Let's go for a break. We'll be right back. Welcome back from the break. We're still here with Lena Pira, a publisher and a missionary. For long, we had so many foreign writers that I don't know why, but for me, there was a point at which I would feel pained when almost every speech writer or every speech really, someone has to quote someone foreign. Like this one said, and in my head I'm thinking, what do we say?
Yes, I think there's several reasons for it. One, I think we used to have a bit of a lower quality when it came to publishing. And so when people were looking for a high quality book, they didn't think to say, let's find, because people were looking to cut corners, how do I print this cheaply? You know, how maybe my friend will edit it instead of me getting an editor, professional editor. And so the quality of the books didn't really entice people to buy them. That was, I think, an issue. But two, there was also this perception that outside knows more. They, you know, but it's not true. It's something that I think people got in their mind that said, okay, that, you know, those ones must have more expertise in the area. Let me read them. But the thing I'm excited about is that now you're seeing more local books. You know, and we started as a company. I own a company called Leap Publishers. So Leap started an ebook platform called africanbooks.com. It's our digital platform for ebooks. And the thing I love about
Amazon.
It's our Amazon, exactly. But the thing I love about it, it is for African authors. We have, I think we don't even have any books from non-African authors. The authors might be around the world. They might be in the diaspora. They might be, you know, they can be spread out. As long as they have some form of African heritage, they are allowed to use that site. And so that's, as that site grows, it like becomes a hub of African content where we can access. And the beautiful thing is we have several books from Ghana, we have some books from Kenya, and I love seeing the diversity just in Africa. So like when I look at the Ghanaian books, they are interesting, like they are fictional short stories, some of them are science fiction, some of them are romance stories. But then when I look at Kenyan, Ugandan books, some of them are more like non-fictional self-help, you know, educative. And so we have such a large diversity of content just within Africa that we never used to tap before. But as that site grows, the hub of content is also, it becomes almost a living heritage of what Africa has to say. My heart is, let's get all of the African books, past, present, and future, and put them there. Because it hurts my heart when I was looking for a book the other day by Joseph Lule. It's called The Wisdom of the Baganda. I've been to 3 different bookstores, and they keep telling me they don't have the book. Yet I have a print copy from a long time ago, about 14 years ago, and now it seems like I can't find it anywhere. So what happens when the print copies go out of stock? Can we have soft copies so that we can still access that knowledge? Like, you know, it's something that I'm passionate about, because I wouldn't want such a beautiful work to just get lost in the pages of time, you know?
But now that you're talking about all this content coming from us, Ugandans and Africa generally, the question still begs, are we buying? Are we reading?
We are. Actually, we recently launched a book at the end of, was it 15th of August? The most recent book we launched was on the 15th of August. In the first 2 weeks, it sold 3,500 copies. That's Irene's book. We had only printed 2,500 copies, so we sold an extra 1,000 copies that we had not printed. We had to go back and reprint, and the second time we printed 5,000 copies. So in less than a month, we have printed 7,500 copies, and she sold almost all of them.
And people are still buying.
So, you know, a lot of times people doubt the content that they create sometimes, because I have so many authors who are like, no, Lena, I only want to print 100 copies of my book. And I'm like, no, let's think bigger, you know? Why are you only printing 100 copies? Print 1,000 copies. Like,
I think people are afraid to fail.
A lot of people are afraid to fail, but I'll tell you, we have never published a book that has not sold all of at least 1,000 copies. Yes. Most of our books are in their third, fourth reprint. Some of them have sold between 3,000 to 4,000 copies. Irene so far is the biggest selling at the moment. But we have another one that we just took to print yesterday, and we're printing 5,000 copies first run.
You're testing the water.
We know it's going to sell. We're like, you know what? Let's start big and get bigger instead of start small and grow bigger.
Inverted pyramid.
Yes.
Yeah. What message would you give writers out there? Someone who wants to, you know, delve into book writing. What would you tell them as a publisher from your vantage point? Because everybody tells you we're all born writers, we all have a life worth sharing. But what would you tell someone who's all sold to start writing?
I think writing is a good avenue to let out your thoughts and feelings. But I don't per se think that everyone might have a story to tell that people want to buy.
Ouch. Ouch.
Okay, if we're being honest, okay. I've had some people come to me with manuscripts and they're like, this is a book, and I read it and I'm like, what does this add to me? Or what does this add to anyone? Because you've lived a very normal life, you're not telling me anything new, you're not teaching me anything. So by the time I finish reading your book, what have your words added to the reader? We still need to remember that books, I say, are small businesses. So every book you put out there, consider it a small business. You've one, invested your time to develop it. You've invested your money to develop it. did you actually look at the product you're putting out there? And is it a product that the market wants to buy? Because so many people are like, okay, I've written the book, tick. Launch day, they are like, I'm done. They forgot they have to sell the book to make back their investment. So many people, unless your point of writing the book is just to write and to say I've done it and you don't care about actually having income, then that's okay. But look at it as, you know what, I still have to do a market analysis and I have to know what are people reading. Because if I want buyers for my book, I should tailor my message to those guys that are going to buy that book and want to read it, you know? So you have to think of it in that light, especially if you want to become a career author and actually earn money. So people want to hear unique stories. They don't want to read a story that, oh, okay, I woke up in the morning, I ate breakfast, I went to school, I came back home, I did my chores, I went to sleep. I did that for 40 years. Now I am working in an office. What have you told us? What have you added to us? You know, so tell a compelling story. Teach us something that you have knowledge or expertise in, or that you have a unique perspective of, you know. Or, you know, if you're going to do a fictional tale, tell us something that entertains us, that, you know, captures our attention, and something that a reader would want.
Okay. Now, as a publisher, I'm sure you're the best person to ask all these questions.
Yes.
I think writers out there, I have you. So, usually people tell you, like you've just said, you have to share your most interesting bits, yeah, to captivate readers. But in your experience, has anyone ever shared their interesting bits that later backfired? Like, let's say someone talks about their marriage explicitly, or you know, something happened at work and then they perhaps lose a job or something. Have any of your writers got
Fortunately none of the ones I've worked with have, but I have warned people, because people will come with manuscripts. There was one lady who came with a manuscript and she wanted to write about drug abuse, and so she was writing it for a course she was taking. And her example was her husband who was addicted to drugs.
Okay.
I advised her, and I don't know if she took my advice or not, but I advised her, don't write about your husband explicitly. Either make it a fictional story and fictionalize the tale so that people who don't know you personally don't know you're actually talking about your husband, because eventually your children are going to grow up. They're going to want to know, why are we talking about daddy like this? You have a written thing that you can't take back. Once print is out there, it's very hard to get it back, you know? And there's authors time immemorial who have written things down and they want to take it back. And they can't, or they have to start, they write a new edition and they backtrack and say, you know, I was wrong and da da da, you know. The only way to erase print is either with new prints, you know. But these books live beyond us. So when we've passed away and our book is continuing 200 years from now, you're not going to be there to say, by the way, I made a mistake there. People are going to read it and they're going to be like, oh, okay. So you have to be very careful, because you don't want to destroy, just like they say in business, you don't want to destroy bridges. In your writing, you have to be careful. You don't want to destroy your family. You don't want to destroy your personal relationships. You don't want to destroy your reputation. There's a wise way to craft things and not throw people under the bus. I don't know if you've read Destined by Irene.
I have.
She talks about a lot of personal things.
I know.
But she doesn't throw herself under the bus, neither does she destroy any of the relationships with the people she talked about in that book. So there's always a wise way to do it. But I would say get an editor you trust and some advisors that you trust that can read those manuscripts and say, you know what, here, Jackie, yeah? Go slow. Here, rephrase this. Here, you know.
Remove.
Yes, because there's things I'll read in a book and I'll tell the author, that one, you're either going to rephrase it or you're going to remove it. You know, there's something with checks and balances when you work with a good publisher. Your publisher doesn't want to see you, the author, destroyed. So we protect you but we still tell the authentic story. So that's why you don't want to just go in by yourself and write willy-nilly and yeah, be careful, go slow. Also, I've had authors come to me, let's say they're writing an autobiography and their life has been hard, and they want to tell their story, but they don't want to tell everything. When the reader reads it, they can know when you're lying to them.
True.
So if you're not ready to tell your story and tell it authentically, don't. Give it time. Like, just wait and let it come to fruition when the story is ready. Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, Lena. Good night, viewers. This has been Lena Pira. Till next time, goodbye.